give us some men who know the truth.
I just stood up here and talked about broth. Anyway.
What's wrong with you people?
What is Jesus' jeopardy? Jesus was playing a little game, and he said, who do other people say that I am?
And who will declare the truth?
Now this is called the Drenchinator. You see it?
Hey, baby, I'm flying my bungalow in my head. I'm a shake,
you want to know how that one man dying alone for a few short hours on a tree can save a multitude of men from an eternity in hell? Because that one man is worth more than all of them put together.
We gotta read some scripture to make this.
And who will stand with Athanasius and Polycarp and Calvin and Luther and Whitfield and Edwards? And who will declare from the housetops that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation?
Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere, preaching the word. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them. And the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed and lame were healed. And there was a great joy in that city, but there was a certain man called Simon who previously practiced sorcery in the city and astonished the people of Samaria, claiming that he was someone great, to whom they all gave heed from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And they heeded him because he had astonished them with his sorceries for a long time. But when they believed Philip as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, both men and women were baptized. Then Simon himself also believed. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and was amazed seeing the miracles and signs which were done.
I want you to open your Bible to the 8th chapter of Acts, because we're going to look at the history of a man by the name of Simon, not Simon Peter. Simon was a common name. We're going to look at the man Simon, who was a dweller in Samaria, and we're going to see in him an illustration that is very important and telling and far-reaching. Because Simon illustrates for us the faith that does not save, the faith that does not save. Now, once we've looked at Simon, we are then immediately going to look at a man from Ethiopia. And when we see the man from Ethiopia, we are also going to see the faith that does save. So here in the 8th chapter of the book of Acts, we're going to have a very important contrast between the nature and character of saving faith and that of a false faith.
In my text, we have to realize that Philip has become a touch point for God. And I chose this part of the text because I realized that Philip was playing to win. And he's going to allow us on this evening to study from his life. For those of you who like to take notes, my subject is play to win.
This is a very important chapter in the history of the church for reasons which we noted last time. Because this chapter begins with the great general persecution of the early church, led by a man named Saul, who was in hearty agreement with the murder of Stephen. And on that very day that Stephen was murdered, crushed beneath the bloody stones, Saul led a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. It was a fierce enough persecution that believers were scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, the apostles remaining in the city. Verse 3 says, Saul began ravaging the church. entering house after house and dragging off men and women, he would put them in prison. We saw how the church was born back in chapter 2. We saw how the believers on that day when the church was born were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to declare the wonderful works of God in many languages. And then the apostles began to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the church began to grow. On that very day, 3,000 were saved, and then more were added every day. And in chapter 4, on one day, 5,000 men were added to the church. The church began to grow by leaps and bounds. The gospel began to fill Jerusalem. They literally turned Jerusalem upside down, if not the world upside down, with the gospel. Because of the massive growth of the church, because of the rapid explosion of the gospel, and particularly the declaration that Jesus had risen from the dead, the very Jesus that the elite of Jerusalem had murdered, persecution broke out against this exploding church. That persecution began by jailing the apostles and threatening them against preaching, threatening them that if they preached anymore, they would be beaten. They preached and they were beaten. And then finally, we have Stephen in chapter 7. Stephen, the first Christian preacher to die as a martyr, stoned to death. A stoning, no doubt, led by the man named Saul, who started the persecution and who later became the Apostle Paul.
When we find Philip in the text, just to set it up, I want to give you all some background. So Jesus has been crucified. He's been placed in the tomb. He is resurrected. He has come back onto earth. He's walked around for 40 days, and now he has ascended back to heaven. But when he ascended back to heaven, he didn't take everything with him. He left the Holy Spirit behind. And he gave the apostles and the disciples a charge, and that was to go into all of the world. The only thing is that when we find Philip into the text, one of his comrades in the gospel, Stephen, has just been stoned. And because Stephen has just been stoned, there is now a persecution on all Christians. And it's something that you have to realize, that whenever you are committed to becoming a touch point for God, there will always be a persecution over you being a touch point. And the persecution begins long before you even realize that you are a touch point.
However, neither the persecution of the apostles, threats against the apostles, abuse of the apostles, or even the murder of Stephen, or the other persecution that came out of that murder, could stop the church. It couldn't stop the church. Verse 4 of chapter 8 says, "The ones who were scattered went about preaching the word." And we know the apostles stayed in Jerusalem and did the very same thing. They continued to preach the word in Jerusalem while believers scattered. This was the Holy Spirit using persecution to fulfill the promise of chapter 1 and verse 8, where our Lord had said, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, even to the remotest part of the earth." That began to be fulfilled by persecution. I told you last week, it wasn't that the gospel was so winsome, so popular, that it expanded by its popularity. Not so. It expanded through persecution. Persecution was the catalyst. And it went from Jerusalem through Judea and into the next area, Samaria. Samaria becomes a bridge to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles will actually be reached in chapter 10. Persecution led to preaching, as we saw last time. Preaching led to productivity, fruitful ministry in Jerusalem, in Judea, and beyond.
Eventually, Philip is going to touch the people of Samaria, and they will become touch points for God too. But while Philip was on the way, he was trying to avoid persecution, not because Philip himself was worthy of being persecuted, but because of what Philip was willing to do for God and the lives connected to his name. The persecution had to begin before he got to his destination. Don't be surprised when you begin to experience persecution before you even get to your destination. It's a sign. Persecution is a sign. When you are a touch point for God, persecution is a sign that you're shaking some things up on the earth. I'm not surprised when I've experienced persecution. Persecution is meant to kill what's inside of you. It's trying to keep that touch point from coming to the fullest manifestation. Yes, so persecution begins before you even know who you are fully. Can we go deeper? Persecution begins when you're a little kid wondering where you fit. Persecution begins when you watch your parents beating one another. Persecution begins when you have an addiction. Persecution begins when you have a teen pregnancy. Persecution begins when you go through a divorce. That persecution that was supposed to convince you that there was nothing in you was really trying to keep you from recognizing that God had placed so much in you. So much in you that it would affect everything connected to you. And so the enemy begins a plan thinking that if I can persecute them early, then they'll never develop fully. But little did they know that the persecuted find a way no matter what.
Now, last week also, in verse 5, we were introduced to one of the early preachers who was a deacon in the church, so introduced in chapter 6 by the name of Philip, not to be confused with the apostle Philip. This is a different Philip. He went down from Jerusalem because Jerusalem is high. He went down to the city of Samaria, that's going north, and began proclaiming Christ to them. Philip now becomes the key character. As Stephen dominated chapter 7, Philip dominates chapter 8. It is Philip who encounters Simon the magician. It is Philip who encounters the Ethiopian. It is Philip then who confronts the reality of false faith as well as the reality of true faith. Philip confronts Simon and the Ethiopian eunuch. These two stories are vital for us, in particular to show the difference between a non-saving faith and a saving faith.
The persecuted find a way, because before he formed me in my mother's womb, he already knew me. So before this life could persecute me, God had already touched me. And now I'm just trying to get back to the touch that created me. I wish I had some people in this room who had gone through some persecutions that was supposed to take them out of the game. But no matter what happened to them, they found themselves back on their knees crying out for God. God, I know I'm not worthy. God, I know I don't deserve it, but I can't get this touch off of me. Man tried to touch me, but your touch came rising to the top. Every time hell tried to touch me, it had to back away. Because before life touched me, God touched me. Before pain touched me, God touched me. Before hurt touched me, God touched me. And I'm just trying to get back to that touch. That touch is where my power is. That touch is where my creativity is. That touch is where my strategy is. That touch is where my healing is. Can I be a church girl in this place for a minute? I'm trying to get back to the touch. I'm trying to get back to the one who created me.
And by the way, from what I read, you could tell that Simon looked like a true believer. We read that he believed in verse 13. He believed. We read that he was baptized and that he continued. And you might say that someone who believes and is obedient to baptism and continues to follow fits all qualifications of a true believer. He believed. He was obedient to baptism. And he continued. It looked good on the surface. Philip himself was even convinced. Philip had no reason to be suspicious. He continued on. Verse 13 says, with Philip. Philip didn't really discern that this was not a true believer. That only became apparent when the apostles Peter and John showed up, and we'll look at that in just a moment. Now, our Lord said back in Matthew 13 that there would be people who would respond initially, but would have no depth and they would eventually die out because of not wanting to suffer tribulation or because of the love of the world and riches. They would fruitlessly die away. He also said that the true and the false would grow together and it would be hard to tell them apart. He also said that the kingdom is like a big net thrown out that drags in all kinds of things, good, bad, and indifferent. Simon, with all his possibility, Simon, with all that looked good, lost out on salvation.
I'm trying to get back to the original touch. Before heartbreak, before hurt, before pain, there was an original touch. He formed me. I know he did, because there's no way I should even be in this room. And I can't shake that touch. And every time I get in the presence of God, I'm just trying to be reminded of that touch, that you still see me, that you still know me, that you hear my prayers, that I'm not in this thing on my own. God, touch me just one more time. That's what desperation is. That's what worship is. God, if you just touch me one more time, then I know that I'm at the right place at the right time. I can't afford to lose that touch. If I get connected to somebody and I can't feel that touch anymore, I gotta disconnect, because I'm living for a touch. I'm living for something bigger than me. I'm living to change this world, and I can't change this world without the one who formed this world, so I got to stay connected to the touch.
And as we look at his life and see the narrative that the Spirit of God has given us through Luke, we can see four characteristics of false faith manifest in this man, Simon. He had a wrong view of self. He had a wrong view of salvation. He had a wrong view of the Spirit, and he had a wrong view of sin. His view of self was egotistical. His view of salvation was external. His view of the Spirit was economic, and his view of sin was evasive. All wrong views. And by the way, he is no solitary tragedy. He is simply an illustration of a tragedy that goes on all the time.
Philip had been touched. And now that touch was under persecution. I was studying, and there was something about this persecution that I thought was necessary for us to understand. I wrote down in my notes that persecution doesn't kill God's objective for your life. It only changes the position that he's going to do it from.
So let's meet him and start out with a wrong view of self, a wrong view of self. Egotistical, you might say. This is a common reality that keeps men from faith, that saves. Egotism, pride. They think they're good. They think they're important. That was Simon. He had far too high a view of himself. That faulty view keeps many out of heaven. Simon is introduced in verse 9. Now there was a man named Simon, who formerly was practicing magic in the city of Samaria, which of course is mentioned back in verse 5. And he was astonishing the people of Samaria, claiming to be someone great. He was practicing magic, magion in the Greek, magic, to be skilled in the art of the Magi. You remember the Magi who came to visit the Christ child? They were sorcerers. They were stargazers. They were magicians. That's what the Magi means. They were the ones who, with their arts and magic, tried to discern the times and discern reality and understand the purposes of the divine mind. They were pseudo-scientists whose superstitions basically were very influential in the Medo-Persian realm. They were like priests but not priests of God and not priests of the true revelation of God. They were priests who didn't know God and who conjured up their superstitions and their magical arts. In fact, the term magi or magic came eventually to refer to more than just the magi themselves. It came to refer to all practice of magical arts of any kind. Astrologers, soothsayers, sorcerers, any pagans who dealt in incantations, charms, spells, divinations, horoscopes, they could pull off some amazing things, as magicians can today, by sleight of hand, by deception, by trickery, and also were aided and abetted by demonic powers.
So, when Philip gets persecuted, he has to leave Jerusalem. If he were trying to keep from losing, he would have stopped trying to preach the gospel. But because he was committed to playing to win, even though he wasn't in the position where he first received the touch, he didn't allow his position to kill his objective. I'm on a mission, and I'm playing to win. And persecution, it moves you, it shifts you, it changes your occupation, it changes your location. Persecution shakes up your life, but I want to know, did persecution change your objective? I feel God on that. Yeah. Did persecution change your objective? The moment you begin to realize that it was going to be harder than you imagined to realize the purpose that God placed on you, did you change your mind about what he wants you to do?
The Samaritan people were generally superstitious. Now remember, the Samaritans had long since been cut off from the true religion of Israel. When they were taken into captivity 700 years before this, they were destroyed at that point as a kingdom. They were the northern kingdom, capital city Samaria. And then they were repopulated, the Jews that were left, with pagan nations with whom they intermarried and created a half-breed kind of nation, and they had a kind of an eclectic, syncretistic form of religion. They mixed some parts of the Old Testament with superstition and magic. They had fallen under the spell of this man, Simon, and his magical powers. So here we meet, really, the first false teacher to sort of infiltrate the church with his heresy. He is for sure the first false teacher to propagate what later became known as Gnostic ideas. Now, Gnosticism as a sort of a philosophy of religion didn't really come into shape until much later than this. But the seeds of Gnosticism are already in the New Testament. They're in some of the writings of the apostles in the New Testament. You can see them here in Simon. What is Gnosticism? It's from the Greek word gnosis, which means people in the know, people who have the secret knowledge, people who have the elevated knowledge, people who feel that they have ascended beyond the hoi polloi, the masses, and they somehow commune with God or gods. The Gnostics were those who are the only ones who had access to the divine secrets. You see some of this still lingering in things like the Masonic movement. They claimed, actually, not only to commune with gods, but they claimed to be gods. They claimed deity in some form. And that's what we find with Simon. He had been placed in Samaria by Satan to gain the confidence of the people, to keep them in bondage to a counterfeit power, literally a satanic power, and to oppose the truth. And he had plied his trade for a long time with measures of success. In fact, verse 9 says, he had astonished the people. You might translate that he had bewitched them, or he had duped them, or he had put them under his spell, claiming to be someone great, a mega star in the world of sorcery and magic. This indicates his wrong view of himself. He thought he was someone great. Now, if you think you're someone great, if you think you're someone who has transcended the hoi polloi, if you think you're an elevated person, if you think you have inside connections to the deities, you're far from the necessary humility that is required to come to true salvation.
Yeah, Philip was playing to win, but not all of us are playing to win. That's why we're here. Some of us are trying to keep from losing. And when you're trying to keep from losing, your objective can be changed very easily because you're trying to avoid a loss. But when you're playing to win, and what God placed on you must come forth by any means necessary, you'll waitress during the day and write at night, because I still have an objective, even though my position has changed. I'll cry in the nighttime, but then I'll get up in the morning and put my game face on, because I'm on an objective. And just because I'm being persecuted doesn't mean that my mission has changed. I need you to know that persecution doesn't change your mission. It only changes your position. And it makes you say, okay, God, now this is where you have me, so tell me what I'm supposed to do from here. Because I'm going to do it. Because you told me that no one else could do it but me. So God, show me how to be effective in this position. Because the persecution can't convince me that you didn't call me. Because you touched me. And because you touched me, I know that the persecution is trying to keep me from multiplying that touch that radically changed my life.
He announced that he was a great miracle worker from God. Notice verse 10. And they all, meaning the people of Samaria, from smallest to greatest, not size, but influence, power, prestige, from the smallest, most insignificant people to those who were in leadership, they were giving attention to him, saying, this man is what is called the great power of God. Now, that is a pretty elevated accolade. Simon seems to have taught, along with the practice of magic, that sort of pseudo-philosophy which we find later developed in Gnosticism, that he was an elevated being. The idea was that God had disclosed himself in a series of emanations, a series of descending or ascending, depending on what perspective you take, emanations from himself. These emanations were called powers, and there were lower powers, and there were middle powers, and there were higher powers, descending all the way down to man, so that somewhere between man and God were these levels of divine emanation and divine power. The Samaritans were convinced by Simon himself that he was the great power of God, the chief of one of these powers, a very elevated emanation close to God himself, almost a sort of God in human form. By the way, this is precisely how the Mormons see Jesus. Jesus is not God. He is an emanation from God. He is a great power of God, elevated above man, but below God. The Mormons also believe that Satan is the same. He is the spirit brother of Jesus, who is also a created emanation. Well, Satan used this man to counterfeit divine power and hold the people captive. That's the business Satan is in.
So Philip says, I was persecuted into position. I didn't get into position because everything went the way that I thought it would. I didn't get into position because I had the right parents and the right background. I didn't get into position because someone handed me a fat check. I didn't get into position because life for me hasn't been no crystal stair. What y'all know about that? I didn't get into position because everything was easy for me. I was persecuted into position. I had to cry myself into position. I had to run away from some things to get into position. And then I looked around and recognized that I was exactly where I was supposed to be, because the gospel must be spread throughout all the world. So he put me in the middle of a situation I never wanted to be in, because he knew that touch would rise to the top. Persecuted into position. I was persecuted into position. I went through a teenage pregnancy. I went through a divorce, all so that I could be your pastor. If life had gone for me the way I wanted it to, I would never be here. But I was persecuted into position. I was persecuted into purpose. I was persecuted until I said, by any means necessary, what God placed down on the inside of me must come forth. You threw a stone, but it cracked open my oil. Oh, I feel God on that. The persecution cracked open my oil. It cracked open my power. Thank you for the persecution. Thank you for walking away from me. Thank you, because it didn't go the way I wanted it to. I got persecuted.
So the first thing we see here is that there is an immediate barrier between Simon and true salvation, and that is pride, an inordinate, bizarre pride, an elevated pride that most people wouldn't ever have. They would never claim such identity for themselves. He saw himself as Gnostics saw themselves, as an emanation from God far above everyone else. By the way, that phrase, the great power of God, is used by later theologians to refer to the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, he was no unusual person in the ancient world. As if there were not more magicians, there were astrologers everywhere, soothsayers everywhere, there were magicians everywhere. And in a credulous age, they had great influence. In an age without the benefit of modern science, they made a very comfortable living with their trickery and their demonic power. Many of them believed in their powers. Many of them were conscious frauds, convinced that the reality was just a show, and very adept at pulling it off. There were all kinds. Pride, however, was the barrier in the case of Simon, a real hindrance to anyone to come to Christ. He's a classic example. He made great claims for himself, saw himself in an elevated way. And so this cuts him off from the hope of salvation. Such pride in any form, maybe not as extreme as his, but such pride in any form is a weed springing up in every heart that literally cuts off the growth of true faith. Such pride in the heart is like a robber who conceals himself in the dark recesses of some cave and waits to seize the plunder in the darkness. This is pride. It is a robber. It robs the heart of the possibility of genuine brokenness, repentance, humility, which is necessary for salvation. He had no sense of the fear of judgment. He had no sense of his own wretchedness, his own lowliness, his own sinfulness. It seems that as though he had initially no fear of the reality of guilt and sin and the penalty that could follow.
I got persecuted here. It's too early for that. You can't get them started, because if they start looking back over their life, I'm going to lose the whole memory. I'm going to lose the whole service. Please, it's too early for that. I got some people in this room who got persecuted into purpose. I got some people in this room who went through hell and it came out not smelling like smoke.
Pride dominates sinners. In Herod, it wore the mask of conscience and beheaded John the Baptist. In the Jews, it wore the mask of tender regard for the honor of God and it killed the Son of God. In the Pharisees, it wore the mask of purity of life, when in reality they were vile and filthy inside. Pride is a deadly sin. It cost Nebuchadnezzar his reason. It cost Hezekiah his kingdom. It cost Peter almost his life. It cost man Eden. It doomed Sodom. It sprang up in angels' hearts, cost them heaven. It cost Haman his life. It gave Uzziah leprosy. Pride damns men. Job 35, 12 and 13, the pride of evil men, surely God will not bear vanity. Psalm 10, verse 4, the wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not at all in his thoughts. Psalm 12, verse 3, the Lord shall cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaks proud things. Psalm 101, 5, a proud heart will I not tolerate. Proverbs 6, these does the Lord hate, an abomination to him, a proud look. Proverbs 8, 13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogance and the evil way do I hate. Proverbs 16, 5, everyone who is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Proverbs 16, 18, pride goes before destruction. Proverbs 21, 4, a high look and a proud heart are sin. And so, the sum of it is in James 4, 6. God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. To the humble. Remember in Luke 18, the Pharisee, I thank you that I'm not like other men, even as this publican. And the publican is pounding his chest, not even looking up, and says, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus said, that man went home justified rather than the other. The only people who can be saved are those who are broken over their sin.
God, I thank you for the stones that were thrown in my direction. God, I thank you for the insecurities that made me relatable to your people. God, I thank you that when they walked away, I only had one choice, and that was to create. God, I thank you. I didn't just get here. I was persecuted into position. And the beautiful thing about being persecuted into position is that you don't shake easy. And you don't get scared easy. Because I already survived persecution. And if I can survive persecution, I can survive some gossip and a rumor. I can survive losing a job. I can survive you walking away from me. I got persecuted to be here so that the glory could be manifested in my life. I got persecuted. And now every time I feel persecution, I expect another dimension of glory. Because that's what persecution has done for me. So give me your best shot. I know I've been feeling a little down lately, but I feel my help coming. I feel like I'm gonna start playing to win. And so, hell, I want you to know that you picked a fight with the wrong one. You picked a fight with somebody who's seen God's glory show up in their life. And when he gets finished with me, everything connected to me is going to be a reflection of his glory. I'm going to be a monument of his grace. I'm going to be a monument. I'm going to be a touch point.
But Simon sees himself as someone great. He sees himself as the great power of God. This is a damning self-perception. Job 22, 29 says, when men are cast down, then shall thou say, there is lifting up, and he shall save the humble man. Job 25, 5 and 6, behold, even to the moon, and it shines not. Yea, the stars are not pure in his sight. How much less man? Even the universe, celestial bodies, are not pure in God's eyes. They are stained with the curse. How much less man? Man needs to humble himself. Simon was proud. Justin Martyr, one of the early church fathers, in his apology, says Simon was honored. He was so famous that he was honored with a statue in Rome. In Rome. And the statue said, Simon Sancto Deo. What is that? To Simon, holy God. Well, you can't get more pride than that.
So Philip first experiences persecution. And when my text begins, he's been scattered. And though he's been scattered, his mission has to continue because he's playing to win. And he's not allowing the persecution to make him be silent. But persecution is one level. There's another dimension, and that is opposition. Persecution tries to kill what's in you. Opposition tries to discredit your ability. But the opposition is created to force you to take your game to the next level, because we're playing to win, right? So when I experience opposition, you got to know the difference between persecution and opposition. Persecution is meant to kill what's inside of you before it can be fully manifest. Opposition is when you begin to manifest it, but they try to discredit what you're manifesting. And the opposition is created to force you to take your ability to the next level. Okay. So Philip's opposition is the sorcerer. For years, the sorcerer has been in Samaria, and he's been doing all types of tricks, and he's been doing all types of miracles, and it looks like he and Philip are the same, but they're not the same. And one train of thought would be like Philip was just supposed to go in there and start preaching the gospel, and instantly people would be saved. But he needs opposition, and you need opposition, because opposition forces you to take your game to the next level. I know you don't want any competition. I know you want things to be easy. I know you don't want to have to deal with the IRS, and I know you don't want to have to climb your way up the ladder. But you need opposition, because opposition teaches you how to navigate and maneuver. You need a little opposition in your life, because opposition is how you train. Opposition is how you dig deeper and pull out something that you never thought was down on the inside of you. And I would have never done it unless I had opposition.
In John 5:44, Jesus said this, "How can you believe who receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that comes from God alone?" Also, according to Justin Martyr, you look at verse 11, they were giving him attention because he had for a long time astonished them with his magic arts. Justin Martyr writes that this man Simon was not only famous outside of Samaria so that he had a statue in Rome, at least Justin says that, but Justin Martyr says his birthplace was in the land of Samaria, and he had lived there all his life, and he had kept the people long under satanic bondage. They were duped. They followed a satanic false miracle worker. Still works today, doesn't it? Still works. They had been long in bondage. Now, Simon is extreme, but he illustrates the fact that pride, God hates.
I got to say it the way I studied it, because I think it's important for you to recognize that opposition is your training ground. Some of your oppositions are just toxic relationships trying to discredit your anointing. And so you have to overcome your opposition so that the real version of you can become manifest. You need opposition. Opposition will have you talking to accountants. Opposition will have you creating a business plan and a budget. Opposition will have you preparing on this level for the next level dream that God has already given you. So I gave you opposition on this level so that when you get to this level, you don't have to restructure. I gave you the opposition so that you could start organizing and strategizing and seeing who your friends were and who they really are and seeing where your anointing works and where it doesn't work. I gave you some opposition. Stop praying your opposition away and start asking God, what is this opposition trying to teach me? Because I'm playing to win, I don't just back off easy. I need to know what the opposition is trying to teach me about me and the way that I do what I do.
Secondly, Simon had a wrong view of salvation. He had a wrong view of salvation. His view of salvation was external. Pick it up at verse 12. But when they believed Philip preaching the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were being baptized, men and women alike. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued on with Philip, and as he observed signs and great miracles taking place, he was constantly amazed. I mean, that all sounds so good, but we know there's a fatal flaw that keeps him from true salvation, and it's pride. Here we find out that Simon, when he was exposed to the preaching of the good news about the kingdom of God, that's the gospel of entering the kingdom of God through faith in Jesus Christ. The kingdom of God is the general term for the realm of salvation. Philip is preaching the gospel, telling people how to enter the kingdom of God by faith in the name of Jesus Christ. People were believing, they were being baptized, men and women alike. So, we know now that Acts 1:8 is being fulfilled. The gospel has been preached in Jerusalem, Judea, and in Samaria. As this happens, Simon's hold on people begins to dwindle, and he falls in line. Even Simon believes and is baptized, continues on with Philip. And why? Because he's watching the signs and miracles taking place, and he is amazed, absolutely amazed. He is attracted to the miracle power. That's his business. That's what he does. That's what he's into. Instead of being humble, his pride causes him to follow because he wants in on that power. He knows, as any false healer knows, false miracle worker knows, the difference between what he does and what is real. He knew that. He saw that before his eyes. He knew the difference between demonic deception and between craft and artistic deception, which he was very accomplished at. He was impressed with the power of Philip. It was a real power as opposed to his counterfeit power. And if he could get that power, then he could mix his power with that power and elevate himself even more. He saw this miracle power as a commodity to be added to his arsenal. So he decided to join the movement. This is a wily approach. This is a satanic approach. Satan always wants to join the church. Satan always wants to talk like, act like a believer, a Christian, a true preacher.
Philip has this opposition. And Philip combats the opposition. And that's really what I want to talk about, because we're playing to win. And And Philip recognizes that he has to win the people of Samaria. And the first thing he does is he preaches Christ to them. And the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip. I looked up that word heeded, and it comes from a Greek word that basically means attention. That the people of Samaria, he had the attention of the people of Samaria. So he used what they were familiar with to get their attention. That was the first level of combating the opposition. See, some of you all won't preach like me. Some of you will, you know, but some of you won't grab a microphone. What you're going to do instead is you're going to use what the world has for attention to dilute the power of that which doesn't lead them back to God. I'm creating music and it sounds good, but my music has an ulterior motive. Because my music is trying to become a touch point for God. I am creating a script, but my script has an ulterior motive. It looks like everything you've seen before, but it's nothing you've ever seen before, because there's an ulterior motive working underneath this thing that ultimately is trying to get you back to a point where you can be touched the same way that I had been touched. Are there any kingdom people in this room that are trying to be a touch point? I'm using what gets the world's attention, but only so that I can tell them about my God. So when I say I'm doing it for the kingdom and the culture, what I'm really saying is that I'm using the culture to get them back to the kingdom. The culture has been used against us plenty of times. Now I'm going to use the culture. Oh, so you like fashion? Let's talk about fashion. And after you get dressed, I want to tell you about my Savior. Oh, so you like music? Okay, that's dope. Let's talk about music. But when we get finished talking about music, I want to tell you about a man from Galilee who can give you the power to overcome depression. I want to prophesy to some people in this room that you're going to be in some rooms that you should have never been in. And when you get in there, don't forget that you are a touch point for God. That means don't just talk about an addiction. Break that thing off of them. Don't just talk about what's wrong. Break that thing off of them. You are a touch point for God. And when darkness is in your realm, it ought to get nervous.
So in Simon, we see the first example of one who, having been baptized in the name of Christ, enters into the church with the sole purpose of corrupting the faith he professed. Why is he continuing? Because he loves Christ? Because he is praising God for the forgiveness of sin? No, he continues on with Philip for the reason that he sees the signs and great miracles taking place, and he is constantly amazed. He believes, but listen, James 2 says, the devils believe, right? And tremble. He believes superficially. He wants miracle power. He came not on God's terms, but on his terms. Salvation to him is a commodity to be added to his arsenal. He sees it as something external, not at all internal. He is already the great power of God, and he will use this power if he can gain access to it. If he can find out how Philip does what he does, he will capture this. This is reminiscent of errors that we are familiar with. He believed. He was baptized. In Roman Catholic theology, a book written by Ludwig Ott, the Roman Catholic theologian, we read this. Baptism confers the grace of salvation. Really? Baptism confers the grace of salvation. Simon was baptized. Didn't confer the grace of salvation on him. In the Council of Trent, the Roman Catholic Church said this, and I quote, "If anyone denies that by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is conferred in baptism, the guilt of original sin is remitted, or even asserts that the whole of that which has the true and proper nature of sin is not taken away, let him be damned." Oh. So if you say baptism doesn't confer the grace of salvation, you are damned. Simon was baptized. More quotes. Baptism has the power both of eradicating sin and effecting inner sanctification. Another quote. Baptism effects the remission of all punishments of sin, both the eternal and the temporal. Another quote from Ludwig Ott. Even if it be unworthily received, valid baptism imprints on the soul an indelible spiritual mark. And a final quote, baptism by water is necessary for all men without exception for salvation. But Simon believed. Simon was baptized. He was never saved. He received no grace. He saw salvation as an external thing. I'll do the ceremony. I'll go through the rite. I'll be baptized. So it was an external thing to him.
I'm a touch point. I can go anywhere and I'll still be a touch point. And God will send me anywhere because he knows I'm a touch point. Because he knows that when I get there, I'm really there to cast some things out. I'm really there to push some darkness off of people. Come on, Activate LA. What are you really trying to do in this thing? You trying to get attention for your sake, or you trying to do something that leads people back to God? That's all I want to be, is a touch point. So Philip uses the same thing that Samaria is used to seeing, but he does it a little bit differently. And first they heeded the things that Philip was doing. But something happens in verse 12 where it goes from them just heeding what Philip was doing. Verse 12, if you can put it on the screen for me, verse 12 says that they went from heeding the miracles and the signs and wonders, and then it switched into belief. You got to know the difference between attention and then attention that is converted into belief. I'm saying don't just ask for attention. Give somebody something to believe in. Something to believe in so that when they're no longer with you, they still got power to access what they received when they were in your midst. I don't just want your attention so that I can have a bunch of followers and so that people can say my name is great. I'm actually on a mission. I'm going to use your attention and convert your attention into belief into the one who sent me. I didn't just get here on my own. This is bigger than me. This is greater than me. If you get me, you failed. If you get him, no weapon formed against you will prosper. If you get me, something went wrong. If you get me, something wasn't in alignment. But if I get you back to him, I've turned this attention into belief. Verse 12 says, but when they believed Philip as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ, Philip began preaching about the kingdom of God. He started saying and telling what my father would call the greatest love story of all time. That you started in a realm you cannot see. And life tried to separate you from that realm. But a man named Jesus came and became a touch point so that you could have access to that dimension again. And so while they were marveling at what Philip was doing, Philip flipped the script on them. Because they had spent time marveling at what the sorcerer was doing as well. But this is what Philip did that really flipped the script. He said, everything you see me doing, you can do too.
He had a wrong view of self and a wrong view of salvation. He thought that by being baptized, he'd be in. And now he could tap into the power. And that leads me to say, thirdly, that he had a wrong view of the Spirit. A wrong view of the Spirit. He had a wrong view of himself, egotistical. He had a wrong view of salvation, external. He had a wrong view of the Spirit, economic, I guess you could say, if you want an E word. Verse 14. Now, when the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For he had not yet fallen upon any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they began laying their hands on them, and they were receiving the Holy Spirit. Now, this is a very important thing for us to understand. What is going on here? Well, in verse 14, we see that news about the marvelous response to Philip's preaching in Samaria reached Jerusalem. Okay? It reached Jerusalem. Peter and John, the leading apostles, the ones who dominate the opening chapters of the book of Acts, the ones who were together, Peter the main preacher, John always with him. These two leading apostles, part of the inner circle of our Lord, were sent to inspect the work. They were going to go see if this was genuine, if it was real. The evangelization of this hybrid, quasi, semi-Gentile, schismatic people called Samaritans. Was it real? Was it legitimate? Peter and John, still together, together since they were long before when they were with Jesus, a great team. Peter was ardent. Peter was bold. Peter was zealous. John was the perfect, strong-willed, faithful, loyal companion. Why did they come? To assess the work, to look at the harvest, to maybe give some help to Philip, to give the sanction of the apostles on what was going on, and thirdly, to confer the Holy Spirit. And this then brings up the issue, because in verse 15, it says, they came and prayed for the people who had believed and been baptized, the genuine believers, that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for he had not yet fallen upon any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. You say, well, wait a minute. I thought that when you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit came immediately. That's true now. That's true. But the book of Acts is a historically critical time for transition. Very, very important. Why didn't the Samaritans receive the Holy Spirit at the very instant they believed, as believers do now? I'll tell you why. Because the Jews needed apostolic testimony and apostolic evidence that they were to be included in the one church. Why? Because the Jews basically hated the Samaritans. The Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. For 500 years, they had worshipped in Mount Gerizim on their own. The Jews in the south and the Samaritans in the north each claimed in their own way to be God's chosen people. There was intense rivalry between them. Jews didn't even go through Samaria. It would have been very difficult for the Jews in Jerusalem and in Judea who had come to faith in Jesus Christ and received the Holy Spirit to believe that the Samaritans were in the one church, the one body, baptized into the one body, as 1 Corinthians 12 says. Strife between the two, the Jews and the Samaritans, would have been perpetuated unless the apostles came, identified the fact that they were true believers and that they were there when the Holy Spirit came upon them, that they were thus placed by the Holy Spirit into the same body as the Jews. There was always the danger of two churches, separation. There had to be Jews present. Now remember, Philip was a sort of a non-Judean Jew. He was a Hellenistic Jew, as were the deacons in Acts 6. Now the rest of the people are Samaritans. They need Jews there to witness this unity, and not just any Jews, but the most trustworthy witnesses, Peter and John, so that everybody knows that the Holy Spirit came in the same way on the Samaritans that he did on the Jews at the day of Pentecost. And I believe that's exactly what happened Because, verse 17 says, these apostles began laying their hands on these believers, and they were receiving the Holy Spirit, and Simon saw that the Spirit was bestowed through the laying on of the apostles' hands. How did he see that? How did he know that? That's invisible. The Holy Spirit is invisible. How did he know that? It's my conviction, conviction of most Bible students, that the same manifestation that occurred at the day of Pentecost occurred here again. What was that manifestation? The speaking in multiple languages. That there was the very same manifestation, so that they would know the same thing happened to them.
Because the world wants you to idolize them and what they can do. But when you're kingdom, you're meant to activate something down on somebody else. I know you see me shining, but let me tell you, I'm just a reflection of what's down on the inside of you. So when we leave this building, Activate LA, I don't want you just looking for followers' sake. I want you looking for who you can activate. That same thing you see in me, that same peace, that same joy, that same strength that you see in me, you have access to. I'm telling you, don't just marvel at me. Let that activate what's down on the inside of you. Philip flipped the script. You can do miracles too. Everything, I feel that. I'm going to prophesy this. Everything that Samaria had seen up until that point was them marveling at what someone else can do. And perhaps even envying what someone else could do. They didn't realize that it was just a preview of what they could do. And I want to prophesy to some people in this room who have been marveling at the gifts and talents of other people and wondering, why is it they seem so far from what they can do? And I prophesy that everything that you have been marveling is just a preview of what God can do down on the inside of you. That if you will receive this word and the power of the Holy Ghost to destroy every yoke attached to your gift, that you will go from marveling at miracles to being a miracle. God, I didn't just come here to look at someone else shine. God, I came here because you placed the light that's down on the inside of my soul. And God, I'm burning to do something for you. I'm burning to convert this attention into belief. I'm burning.
Let me show you chapter 10, verse 44. In chapter 10, the gospel goes to the Gentiles. It reaches the Gentiles. And Peter is there again. Peter is speaking to the Gentiles, Caesarea, opening his mouth in verse 34, he preaches, and people are responding. Everyone who believes in him, verse 43, receives forgiveness of sins. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who were listening to the message. All the circumcised believers, the Jews who came with Peter, were amazed. Why were they amazed? Because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. I mean, the Jews were very, very narrow. I mean, go back to Jonah. They didn't like the idea of alien people coming into their covenant. So God had to repeat the phenomena of the coming of the Holy Spirit and the presence of the apostles, not only to the Samaritans, but even when it happened at first to the Gentiles. And look at verse 46. How did they know the Holy Spirit had come? How did these circumcised believers, Jewish believers, know this? They were hearing them speaking with languages and exalting God. And that's exactly what they had done on the day of Pentecost. So we can assume that that also happened in chapter 8 in Samaria, and that's what Simon saw, that phenomenon.
God is not tormenting you with what you've seen. And he is not taunting you and trying to make you believe that you cannot do it. It is a preview of what is down on the inside of you. Philip never lost sight of his mission. Philip realized that if I perform miracles and I leave it at that, and I don't convert the people, then I didn't do what God called me to do. Philip knows that he's moving past Samaria. And every time he's moving past an arena, every time he's moving past a level, he's trying to create a conversion. You are where you are right now because you have the power to create a conversion in that realm. A conversion of depression into joy. A conversion from suicide into abundant life. There's power. You've been in this ministry. You're in this room right now. This is not by coincidence. This is divine strategy. You have the power. You have resurrecting power to go into your places of work, to go into your relationships, to go into your families. Come on, somebody. You can run up on addiction. Come on, somebody. I wish I had some people. See, they were hungry in Samaria because they had been without power for so long. Don't get so comfortable with power that you start looking at other people's power and not asking God to give me another dose of power, because I want to cast some addiction off of people. I want to send some people into rehab so that they can live to the best version of who they are. I want to do something in this earth. I don't want to just go to church is what I'm saying. I don't want to just know worship songs is what I'm saying. I want to pass by environments and shake everything up because I came carrying something that can change your life. You have the hidden sauce.
If you look at chapter 19 of the book of Acts, chapter 19, here are some sort of wandering Jews this far into the book of Acts, and they're literally followers, disciples. And Paul says to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said, "Well, we haven't even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." Well, he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was coming after him, that is, in Jesus." Oh, so we're supposed to move from John to Jesus. These are people, look, there was no internet. They're floating around somewhere. They haven't even transferred from the forerunner to the Messiah. So Paul says, you need to believe in Jesus. And so when they heard the gospel, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And then Paul, who is the apostle, laid hands on them and the Holy Spirit came on them and they began doing what? Speaking with languages. And proclaiming the wonderful works of God. And there were just 12 of them. They're sort of the last little group. The Samaritans were declared to be believers, true believers, placed into the body. The Spirit comes, they have the same phenomena as on the day of Pentecost. The Gentiles have the same phenomena as the Spirit comes under the presence of the Apostle Peter, under the presence of the Apostles Paul. These sort of wandering followers of John the Baptist are also to be included in the one body, the one Spirit. That's why the apostles had to come for the laying on of hands of these true believers in Samaria so that all would always know that they were one with the Jews in Christ and so with the Gentiles. Look at chapter 11 of Acts. Peter is giving his testimony about what happened when he went to Joppa. And he basically says, the Spirit told me to go, and I went. And if you just come down to verse 15, "And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them in the same way, just as he did upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he used to say, 'John baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' Therefore, if God gave to them, the Gentiles, the same gift he gave to us, also after believing in the Lord Jesus, who was I that I could stand in God's way?" I mean, this is Peter saying, I would like to have prevented the Gentiles from being one with us. couldn't do it. When they heard this, they quieted down, they glorified God, and said, "Well then, God has granted to the Gentiles also the repentance that leads to life." God granted it to the Gentiles also. Chapter 15, verses 8 and 9, "And God, who knows the heart, testified to them, giving them the Holy Spirit, just as He also did to us. And He made no distinction between us and them, cleansing their heart by faith." That's what Peter said.
You kingdom, baby. Can I get gully with y'all? Y'all know how I like to do. You kingdom, baby. Everywhere you go, things ought to shift. You kingdom, kid. Everywhere you go, darkness ought to back off. Come on, activate LA. Where you at? What you trying to do? You trying to be like the culture? You trying to do it for God? I'm trying to do something in this industry. I'm trying to do something in this city. I'm trying to do something for my siblings. I'm trying to activate everything that God placed down on the inside of them. It can't just be me on stage. I'm not excited until everybody is in. Everybody's got to get some. Everybody needs some power. Anytime I see a homeless person, anytime I see addiction, anytime I see brokenness, anytime I see fame but no power, I see that I'm the answer. I see, God, why you placed me here. It wasn't about money and it wasn't about fame. It wasn't about my name in life. It was about me unleashing this power so that they could unleash their power, so that we could wage war on hell. Can I preach some kingdom talk to some people in this room? It's gonna be a chain reaction. It's gonna be a chain reaction. They're gonna still be talking about God when I leave this place. They're gonna still be talking about joy when I leave this place. I'm changing the culture, baby. And I'm doing it armed with power. And I'm doing it armed with heaven's resources. Spirit of the living God, you're still alive. You're still performing miracles. The kingdom of God is still at hand. The kingdom of heaven is still here. And God, I'm looking for marching orders. God, I'm looking for you to send me. The kingdom of heaven is still here. How do I know? Because I still see darkness. And if I still see darkness, there's still work for me to do. If I still see pain, there's still work for me to do. If I still see depression, there's still work for me to do. If addiction won't let somebody go, it's still work for me to do. If there's still abuse, it's still work for me to do. God, let me know what I'm supposed to do in this season. I want to bring your kingdom into Hollywood. I want to bring your kingdom into my marriage. I want to bring your kingdom to the White House. I want to bring your kingdom everywhere I go, because your kingdom came to me and it changed my life. So I don't play for me no more. I play for him. And I hear you coaching me that my next game is coming up. And I hear you training me that this time I'm gonna win. And I hear you coaching me to leave some people alone and to connect with some people who understand what the kingdom is, and to connect with some people who know who I am in the kingdom. Bring forth more of your kingdom out of my life, out of my creativity, out of my finances, until hell gets nervous. Seek ye first the kingdom. Come on, activate. We gotta turn this city upside down. I don't wanna see another homeless person. I don't wanna see another addiction. I don't wanna see another suicide. Not if I'm still here. God, give me a word and I'll speak it. Give me an idea and I'll create it. Impart your spirit into everything I do. I don't just wanna perform miracles. I want to multiply miracles. I want to lead people back to you. I want to show them that you can be pure and still in this industry. I want to show them that you can be pure coming from the background that I came from. I want to show them that forgiveness is real. I want to show them that restoration is possible. I want to show them that you are a redeemer. My God, if there are any redeemed people in this room, can you just say so? Can you just say so? Let the redeemed of the Lord. I should have been strung out, but I got redeemed. I should have been broken, but I got redeemed. I should have been crazy, but I got redeemed.
Now go back to chapter 8. The Holy Spirit comes when the apostles arrive, in order that everyone will know the same salvation, the same Holy Spirit has created one church, Jews, Samaritans, Gentiles, and a few loose followers of John the Baptist, all included. Well, when Simon saw that the Spirit was bestowed through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money. He offered them money. Isaiah 55, where the invitation is come without price, without cost, without money. Simon wanted to buy the true Holy Spirit. What's going on today is that false teachers are trying to sell the false spirits. They've inverted it. Simon says, give this authority to me, verse 19, as well, so that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit. I want this power. I need this power. I'll buy it. You ever heard the word simony? You know that word? Look it up in the dictionary. This man gave us that word in English. What is simony? It is the buying and selling of ecclesiastical offices. It is the buying and selling of ecclesiastical power. If you will, it is the buying and selling of indulgences. It is the buying and selling of church offices, papacies. Simon had a very high view of himself and a very low view of God. He did not understand the glory of the Holy Spirit. He didn't know that nothing that God has is for sale. All that he offers is free, but it's to the broken, contrite heart, repentant, and truly believing in Christ. So, Simon has exposed himself on the spot, and Peter pounces. Verse 20, but Peter said to him, may your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. This is holy indignation. This is pretty salty fisherman prose, by the way. One commentator said, Peter told Simon to go to hell. That's where you can go with that request. Perish. Apaleia. Destruction. He didn't coddle that false teacher. He shot him down fast and hard. You, he said in verse 21, have no part or portion in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Philip didn't see that at first. Peter saw it for what it is. You have no part in the grace of God. You have no part in salvation. You have no part in Christianity. You have no part in the church. You are not a Christian because your heart is not right. Your heart is defiled. You can't buy the Holy Spirit. He had a wrong view of self. He had a wrong view of salvation. He had a wrong view of the Spirit. And finally, he had a wrong view of sin. Verse 22, Peter hit him hard, unmasked him as a wolf, a false Christian, a dangerous Christian. But he called him to repent. Therefore, repent of this wickedness of yours and pray the Lord that, if possible, the intention of your heart may be forgiven you. Pray for your forgiveness. Repent, metanoeo, turn 180 degrees, go the exact opposite direction. Renounce your sin, turn to God. Lay down your sin, lay hold of Christ. You are, very strong language, in the gall of bitterness. That's a Greek word for bile. You are in the bile of wickedness and the bondage of iniquity. You are a slave to your sin. You must repent. This is the kind of bold evangelism that the early church did, that the apostles did. Sin is a bitter, poisonous thing. It is ruinous. It has to be confronted in this way. What did Simon do? Verse 24. Simon answered and said, and I think there's even some sarcasm here, pray to the Lord for me yourselves, so that nothing of what you have said may come upon me. Kind of a mockery. Was he frightened? Was he terrified? Was he guilt-ridden? Was he shaken? Was he trembling? I don't know. I don't know. There are some other texts that indicate he was crying, but that is extra biblical text. There's no confession. There's no self-judgment. There's no acknowledging of sin. There's no exhibit of confidence in the Lord. There's no asking for forgiveness. There's no repentance, nothing. But a kind of scornful comment, why don't you pray for me yourselves so that what you've said doesn't happen to me? Sort of cynical statement about those who were preaching the gospel of grace and love. Here is a man who starts out and looks so good, ends up so horribly because he had the wrong view of everything. Lord, it's been a wonderful day.